Let us open in prayer. Father, we thank you for this day. And Lord, it's a difficult day because our hearts are aching. And we miss Jessica. We just thank you for her life, her testimony, how she lived for you and poured her life out truly in the hearts and lives of many other people. Father, we acknowledge your presence this afternoon. We thank you that she's in your presence, rejoicing. And Lord, we pray your comfort and grace upon the family and friends and each of us as a church family and those who knew her. And we just remember her and reflect on her. We just give you thanks. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to begin with a scripture reading from 2 Corinthians. And 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 through 9. And the scripture says, "For we know that the earthly tent which is our house is torn down. We have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For indeed in this house we groan, longing to be clothed with our dwelling from heaven, inasmuch as we, having put it on, will not be found naked. For indeed, while in this tent we groan, being burdened, because we do not want to be unclothed, but to be clothed with that is mortal, may not be swallowed up by life. Now he who has prepared us for this very purpose is God, who gave to us the Spirit as a down payment or as a pledge. Therefore, being always of good courage, and knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord, for we walk by faith and not by sight. And we are of good courage, I say, and prefer to be absent from the body and be home with the Lord. Therefore, we also have as our ambition, whether at home or absent, to be pleasing to him." As I mentioned, right now, Jessica is in the Lord's presence in heaven, rejoicing, and we can only imagine what that's like. But as we do, perhaps the song we're going to sing as a congregation would be reflect that. The song's entitled, "I Can Only Imagine."
Imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
At this time, I'm going to share some family memories. The first I'm going to read is from Emily, Sister Emily Bland. She writes, "Well, it's tragic to think about Jessica leaving us so soon. She left behind a lifetime of memories that we can celebrate. Anyone who met Jessica quickly learned there's things to be laughed about and shared. In fact, it was possible to spend time with her without enjoying a gut-busting laugh at some point in the conversation." How true that was. "Jessica's love language was sarcasm, and her jokes were quick-witted and hilarious. While Jessica enjoyed a good laugh, she still had a great love for people, especially children. We'd often sit and talk and laugh about the funny things the kids did or said. Didn't matter whether it's her nieces or nephews or cousins or friends' children, she cherished them all. Being only 20 months apart, Jessica and I were buddies from the very beginning. Growing up so close, we shared a lot of the same experiences. I remember when we were around 5 or 7, Mom did not let us take our dolls outside. So we thought we were so smart, we would throw our dolls out our bedroom window, run past Mom, and outside we went to play. And then to get them back in the house, we wouldn't have to go in alone and go to the window, which is usually my job, and the other would throw the dolls up to be caught. We weren't the best at this, but it took many attempts before the dolls were safely inside, and Mom was none the wiser. Well, one day, though, we hurriedly threw the dolls out the window and ran outside to play. We didn't realize that Mom had not only saw us, but almost hit her with the dolls. It was a good run while it lasted. While we were little, Jessica was good at leading, and I was good at following. She would even speak for me most of the time. We liked to cure our boredom by bothering our little brother Jeremy. Our brother Jeremy. He was a big brother, actually, but especially when he had a girlfriend over. We would put dead bugs in her hair, make her play in the mud with us, and make sure we were extra close with him when we were trying to have moments alone. Then we'd act innocent anytime Jeremy complained about his annoying little sister as the mom. Even back then, she was always making me laugh. Jessica got the nickname early in life as Messer Jesser, because she was such a messy and klutzy kid. This did not go away in childhood, or in adulthood, excuse me. I remember one morning standing in the kitchen, drinking coffee and chatting with Jessica. She was making some ranch dressing, and she went to turn around with a ranch bowl, and her finger slipped, and she tried to catch it, and to this day, even though I watched it, I still don't understand how it happened, but somehow, she managed to get ranch all over her kitchen. I mean, all over. Remind me of one of those scenes of a cartoon when something explodes in the kitchen and unrealistically goes all over. We were silent for a good minute before just busting out laughing. We were still finding ranch in weird places for days afterwards. I remember sleepovers and going to see all the Lord of the Rings in theater with our very enthusiastic friends. We shared so much in those early years. As we got older, our friend groups changed, but we always stayed close. Running errands and finding the next garage sale together was a normal Saturday. Jessica was always planning the next event, whether it was a family gathering, a friend's party, or a church outreach. It was always a good excuse to get together for coffee and go over the details. Jessica was studying to become a family therapist. She had such a love for people. I know Jessica did her best to balance a judging situations accurately and not losing love for the person. 1 John 4:8 says, "Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love." And Romans 12:9 says, "Let love be genuine, abhor what is evil, and hold fast to what is good." We often talk about that balance between holding someone accountable and not sacrificing morals, but still showing them God's unconditional love. Someone we both looked at as a great example was our Grandpa Martin. He shined bright with God's love, yet never enabled sin. Anyone who knew Jessica could feel that balance in her as well. Jessica was very close to her family. friends and her beloved dog, Stark. There are many wonderful aspects of Jessica's life and many ways she touched our lives. She remembered as a wonderful daughter, a sister, a best friend, a fun auntie, cousin, hilarious Bible study leader, and so much more. And all those ways and more, she made her lives richer and more fun. And now she was taken away from so young, of course, there was emptiness and pain, confusion, and anger. However, in many ways, the gift of Jessica's life is still here with us. She lives on in our memories and stories, and even all of us have become what we are because of her. So I encourage you to share today, tomorrow, and in years to come, your memories and stories, and to share the pain of your loss as well. And this way, we will keep the gift of Jessica's life alive. And if Jessica could have said goodbye, I think one thing she would have said would be like this poem shared by Shannon Lee Mosley, entitled, "I Am Free." And the poem reads, "Don't grieve for me, for now I'm free. I'm following the path God laid for me. I took his hand when I heard him call. I turned my back and left it all. I could not stay another day to laugh, to love, to work, or play. Task undone must stay that way. I found that peace at the close of the day. If parting has left a void, then fill it with remembering joy. A friendship shared, a laugh, a kiss. Ah, yes, these things I too will miss. Be not burdened in times of sorrow. I wish for you the sunshine of tomorrow. My life has been full. I've savored much. Good friends, good times, a loved one's touch. Perhaps my time seem all too brief. Don't lengthen it now with undue grief. Lift up your hearts and share with me. God wants me now. He has set me free." Sharing a note from Brother Seth. He writes, "Goodbye, my sister. Goodbye, my friend. Goodbye, my rock. I will see you in the end. The night that I heard what happened to you, I sank to the floor and didn't know what to do. I have so many questions and I have so many whys, but God has his timing and it's much greater than mine. Wish you could hear all the words I want to say. I'll tell them to you when I see you in heaven someday. I'm happy to know you're in a better place, but the hurt and pain just won't go away. Goodbye, my sister. Goodbye, my friend. Goodbye, my one and only Jessica." More words from Sister Ellie Kosadar. "So Jessica and I were 9 years apart. I don't have stories about her child, but I can tell you how she made mine better. She had this wonderful ability to make the most mundane chores enjoyable. We all had to stack the firewood every fall, and I absolutely hated this chore. So Jessica had us pretend that we were all orphan children that needed to stack the wood in order to pay for our dinner. Also, we used to pretend we were starving children, didn't know if we would see another meal when we had a dinner we didn't like." Sounds like Jessica. "She was such an amazing creative woman who always tried to make people's days better. Jessica was a stubborn and determined person. When I was about 14, Jessica showed up at our parents' house and told me we were going to find a waterfall today. We were probably driving down a logging road for about 2 hours before I asked, well, were we going to turn around? Jessica said, no, this waterfall has to be around here somewhere. So we ended up pulling over and we listened for it. We could actually hear it, but unfortunately we didn't know how to get there. Then all of a sudden Jessica just started walking through the thicket toward the sound of the waterfall. I can't tell you how many times we tripped, but the whole time we were cracking up about our willpower to find this waterfall. After we found it, we saw the small footpath we were supposed to take. And when we finally got back to the road, we found that her car was only 20 feet away from the trailhead. To this day, I don't understand how we didn't see it. I'll always remember her belly ache and laughter, and how oblivious we were. None of our trips never seemed like a failure, because no matter how wrong our plans turned out, we were always having a good time just being with each other. You're so dearly missed, my darling sister. I will cherish the memories I have with you. From Bob, both Bob and Jennifer, they just want to just thank everyone for coming today and for loving and caring for Jessica as she loved and cared for each as you well. Bob would like to leave you with this verse. It says, Romans 8:28. It says, "And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose." And at the time, Beth Wright, one of Jessica's many aunts, is going to come and share some words from Jennifer. Thank you.
This is from Jennifer to her Jessica. "The pretty flower necklace represents the honor and pride I've had as Jessica's mom, along with the beauty she has added to my life. The scriptures teach us to raise up a child in the way of the Lord, and that then the child will be to you a garland around your neck, and you will be called blessed. Ever since my children have grown up, I've had this saying, I don't have many friends, so I had to make my own. This is true in my life because my children have become my best friends. So even though I'll always remember my daughter Jessica as that bright-eyed, smart, and humorous baby girl in these pictures, I'll know that our relationship has changed a bit. The next time I see Jessica, we will truly be sisters and friends in the presence of our Lord, our Father God, and his only begotten Son, Jesus. We loved her so much in this life, yet it doesn't compare to what the Father has done for us in the to-be-continued episode. So until then, we will miss her greatly. I would like to take a moment to thank all of my friends for all the work they've done on this difficult task of putting this memorial together and the rest of the hard things that had to be done. Dad and I really appreciate it. Good job, as Liam would have said, would say. We are truly blessed, and we love you all."
At this time, we're going to have a slideshow.
Unforgettable, that's what you are. Unforgettable, though near or far. Like a song of love that clings to me, how the thought of you does things to me. Never before has someone been more unforgettable in every way. And forevermore, that's how you'll stay. That's why, darling, it's incredible that someone so unforgettable thinks that I am unforgettable too. Thank you. and forevermore. That's how you stay. That's why, darling, it's incredible that someone so unforgettable thinks that I am unforgettable too.
I get where I'm going, on the far side of the sky. The first thing that I'm gonna do is spread my wings and fly. I'm gonna land beside a lion and run my fingers through his mane, or I might find out what it's like to ride a drop of rain. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. walk with my granddaddy, and he'll match me step for step. And I'll tell him how I've missed him every minute since he left. And then I'll hug his neck, yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will share the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. So much pain and so much darkness in this world we stumble through. All these questions I can't answer, and so much work to do. I get where I'm going, and I see my Maker's face, I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace. Yeah, when I get where I'm going,
beautiful day. Wish you were here.
Just sharing some of my own thoughts and reflections on Jessica. It's been an honor, and I'm trying to get through without crying. It's been an honor and joy to be considered to be Jessica's pastor and under shepherd. And I remember meeting Jessica soon after we arrived on the field in 1992. We met her family and this almost two-year-old with her bright, dark eyes were just checking us out very carefully, evaluating, even scrutinizing these new weirdos in her life. We watched her grow up over the years, and it was exciting to watch her spiritual development as the faith of her parents became her faith. And she believed in Jesus Christ as her Savior and put her faith and trust in the Bible. We watched her church activities and events, church socials, work days, vacation, Bible school, first attending VBS, later on helping with VBS. It was honored to baptize her in the Delta Beach as she gave a public declaration of her faith in Jesus Christ. We watched her graduate from ACA, American Christian Academy High School, proud day. Exciting to see her go to Ecola Bible College in Cannon Beach, Oregon for a year and came back with lots of questions. If I have a little bit of feedback, can we adjust the volume? Thank you. Came back with a lot of questions, but also a stronger foundation in her faith. I remember and always will miss her phone calls. She called in the evening and, "Pastor, I got a Bible question. I knew it's going to be a good one. It's something very deep and serious." And I remember talking with her many times and pointing her toward related scriptures to help her, for her to help research and dig it out for herself. I remember her as part of the Pirates crew. She, my daughter Faith, and Emily, and Randy McCone, and Seth, and Eva, and I think Ellie, we dressed up as pirates to go to the Pirates of the Caribbean movie, and we discussed our favorite parts afterwards. I think she's bringing some culture in my life. I think I needed it. I remember her giving me a Pirates Captain plaque, Captain's Nest plaque that hung in my office for many years. Plus, she gave me a bottle of pirate-themed blue cream soda, and it sat on my computer desk for years. And finally, I checked the date. I said, "I think it's past the use date." But you can't waste it, so I drank it. I said, "Well, either I'm going to die, or it's going to be the best cream soda ever." And it was the best blue cream soda ever. I remember and watched her just participating in the Center Shot Archery program. She was excited about it, and she involved in that as one of the staff members for a number of years. I remember her vision, her desire to reach her community for Jesus Christ with the Fall Festival, of which this is the year 5 of it. I remember her leading her Bible studies in her apartment, in her home, and she recall asking for information about, Bible study material and pros and cons of what the youth do and stuff like that. Jessica served as a church board deaconess this year, but long before that, she was a deaconess in the truest sense of the word. A deacon or deaconess is one who serves. And she served Jesus Christ in the truest sense by her life, caring for and meeting the needs of others, as you all know. Again, it's been a joy and a privilege and an honor to be her pastor and under-shepherd. And thankfully, now she's in the presence of the great shepherd, the Lord Jesus Christ. As we celebrate Jessica's life and reflect how she touched our lives, there's a certain sense of sadness and loss. We miss her, of course. But even then, there's still hope and anticipation of seeing Jessica again soon. For while Messer Jesser no longer abides on this earth, she is alive and well with her Savior in heaven. And because Jessica knew the Lord Jesus Christ as her personal Savior, we, along with every believer, will someday see her again. And we can rest on 3 promises that God gives to those who die in the Lord. I'm reading from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 17, a very famous and well-known passage of Scripture. 1 Thessalonians 4:13 says, "Well, we do not want you to be uninformed or ignorant, brethren, about those who have died or those who have fallen asleep, that you will not grieve as the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not precede or go before those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we'll always be of the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words." And we find 3 promises in this passage that God gives to those who die in the Lord. The first promise is a promise of a reception in glory for every believer. Paul, the Apostle Paul, is writing, answering the believers in Thessalonica, the city of Thessalonica, what happens when believers who died. And the term it means to be or asleep refers to those who physically died. And he wants us to know that while we do weep, and it's okay to weep when we should weep, we don't weep as those who have no hope. And the reason is this: we know we will see Jessica again. You see, believers do weep, but there's never a final goodbye for believers. It's only, "I will see you soon." And the reason for that hope is the promise we see here of God in this passage. Verse 14 says, "For we believe that Jesus died and rose again. Even so, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus." The Bible teaches that the souls, the immaterial part of us who have died in the Lord, are currently with Jesus in heaven. I read a passage earlier in 2 Corinthians 5, verses 8 and 6 to 8. We prefer to be absent in the body than to be home with the Lord. Believers, if you're not here on this earth in your body, you're with Jesus in heaven. There's no option, no plan B. There's no other place that you're either in this body, on this earth, or with Jesus in heaven. And so every believer who dies is going to immediately be with Jesus. But this passage also reveals that not only that, but Jesus is bringing the souls of those departed loved ones who have gone before us back with him when he comes at the harpazo, or the rapture of the church, to those who are still alive at that time. So in addition to a reception of glory, God also promises a resurrection of the body. We talked about that in 2 Corinthians 5, but also when we see in verse 15, I say to you that the word of the Lord, that we will alive or remain, will not go before those who have fallen asleep, but the Lord himself will descend from heaven and shout with the voice of the archangel, the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. These verses promise that every believer is going to receive a new glorified body. God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. Well, it brings two questions come to mind. I'm just going to ask these questions. I had a good discussion with her on this. Well, wait a second. If a believer dies and goes to heaven, what kind of body do they have now? If they're going to get a new body when Jesus comes with them, what do they have now? It's a very good question. And the Bible gives us just a glimpse in Revelation chapter 6, 11. It's talking about the coming tribulation period of those who die in the Lord during the tribulation era. And they will be each given to them a white robe. They will tell you they should rest a little longer. The number of their fellow servants, your brethren, should be killed as they've been, will be completed also. They're given a white robe, a temporary covering. But to this coming day, they will get a new permanent glorified body. What would that body be like? You say, well, I hope it's not this body I have now, because this one's got some aches and pains. I don't know about you, but you know, these bodies are kind of wearing out. The good news is the new body God has for us is a beautiful body. It is a spiritual body. Yet it's also tangible. It'd be like that of our Lord Jesus Christ when Jesus appeared to the disciples in the upper room. He said, touch me and feel the holes in my side. And they touched him. He was tangible. He ate fish in front of them. And yet he was not bound by gravity, not bound by walls like we are here. He can pass through walls. And those new bodies are that God has for you and everyone who knows Jesus Christ as their Savior, that new permanent body be one that is tangible yet spiritual. It's not bound by the limitations of this material world in which we live. This body is going to be an imperishable body. The medical profession will be out of business. No need for doctors, nurses, no more hearing aids, no more pacemakers, no more artificial joint replacements. It's the body that will not wear out or die. An eternal warranty. That sounds encouraging, doesn't it? It will be a glorious body. The Bible tells us, describes that description of the body in Daniel chapter 12, is to be shine like the stars forever. It'll shine. And it'll be a powerful body also. It tells us on this passage, these descriptives are found in 1 Corinthians 15. It'll be like that of angels, but different. But let me just clarify, angels, people do not become angels in heaven. Angels are a separate order of spiritual beings. When a person dies, they don't turn an angel. You get a new body, but you're not an angel. You're a person. It's a whole separate order of creation that God has. He has created angels, he has people, and believers will have a new glorified body when they go to heaven. Well, God does, not only does God promise a reception of glory, not only does God promise a new body, but he also promises a reunion with loved one. And that's where the hope comes in. Verse 17. 1 Thessalonians 4:17 says, then we who are alive remain, we caught up together with them in the air to meet the Lord in the air, and will always be with the Lord. The Bible teaches that after the dead in Christ, Jesus brings back with them, we receive their new resurrected bodies. In that same microsecond, in a twinkling of an eye, believers who are alive at the earth at the time of the harpazo, the rapture of the church, will also receive their bodies. They'll be caught up. That word harpazo means to be caught up, to be jerked up suddenly. And will be reunited with loved ones. This reunion is twofold. First off, with loved ones who departed and who are in Jesus. We departed with our loved ones, our spouses, our children, our siblings, our parents, our grandparents, our friends. And yes, Jessica. And we'll be together for all eternity. Smiling, hugging, talking, getting caught up on things, enjoying our relationships. Now untainted by sin and any past issues of our previous life on this earth, that's all wiped away. Join each other for all eternity. But second, it will be reunited with Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. He who died for us, we will see him who he loved, whom he worshipped, who he sang to, who he talked to in prayer and served for these short years on this earth. we'll see him face to face. And oh, what a day that will be. We can only imagine. No wonder Paul wrote in verse 18, therefore comfort one another with these words. So today we miss Jessica. There's a hole in our hearts. Yes. The same day we're going to see her again. But they do break, I need to explain that these great promises we've just seen are only for those who are prepared, having put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ as the Lord. My friend, if you're here this morning, you may have been raised in a Christian home. You may attend a church somewhere. You may be a member of a church somewhere. But if you've never put your individual faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior, you believe that He died for your sins, not my sins, not somebody else's sins, but your sins, and rose again, you won't be going to heaven. That's what Jessica believed. She believed that Jesus died for her sins and rose again. If you're not 100% certain, if you were to die today, that you're going to go to heaven, I encourage you, I implore you to be sure of that relationship. Don't leave today without being sure. Talk to me or anyone else here. I would love to tell you how you can know Jesus Christ and experience that joy and peace in your life. Jesus said in John 5:24, He said, truly, truly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and does not come into judgment, but is passed out of death into life. And that life is Zoe life. It means the eternal life, not only in quantity forever and ever, but also in quality, that abundant fullness of life. That was life that was so evident in Jessica's life. She had abundant life. That's what made her different. A life that just poured out in the hearts and lives of either. So as you finally remember Jessica, and we celebrate this new chapter of her life with God in heaven, we can look forward to seeing her again when Jesus comes for his church, or when we too pass from this earth into the presence of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let's close this service with a prayer. Heavenly Father, we commit the soul, an earthen vessel of Jessica Wright, unto your care. Until the coming day when the dead will hear the voice of Jesus Christ and shall come forth at the resurrection of the dead. Heavenly Father, at this time I ask you to just be with Jessica's family and her friends, her church family at this time, that they and we might experience your comfort and your grace, your peace and your strength today, not only just today, but in the days and months to come. And Father, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. This concludes our service. We'll be having a reception, and we invite you to join us in a fellowship down the hallway for a reception, but please be patient. Give the kitchen crew a few minutes to get the food out. There's plenty of food, lots of food, but give them a chance to get it out, and then you're welcome to get your beverage and find a seat while you're doing that, and when the food is out, you're welcome to go through and serve, and thank you for coming today on behalf of the family. This ends our service.